Hello and welcome everybody. Before I start the second part of this video, I just want to say that the protest of Muslims in the United Kingdom about Butterley School for showing the Prophet cartoons is a clear intimidation strategy to make people afraid of contesting Islamic ideology. And as a free thinkers, we don't believe in respecting ideas and ideology. Respect can only show to a human being or a person that is living with us. You cannot insult people directly, but ideas have no right or respect.
We can see that the Islamic law was dealing with the situation on the ground as it was at the time. Slavery was very rampant up until the 17th century. There was hardly any voice that said that.
Here we go again. Other people allow it to do, then Islam is okay. We are talking about the creator of the universe. We are talking about Islam that say he is the last religion and the perfect religion. We are talking about the Quran, the word of God. Are you for good or I am going to remember you again?
Anything was wrong with slavery. Slaves were widely owned.
So then it's okay. Then Allah does not know that slavery is bad and he look at up from the sky and see the slavery is working, money is coming and money is going. He said, oh, if I will stop the slavery, people won't follow the Islam and this whole thing gonna collapse. So let's the slavery go on.
The founders of the United States of America, which is one.
What's the United States have to do with God? You know, I just want to know what the United States have to do with God. God is God, the United States people who do that. The people that time was have slavery. Now in this era, they agree all to abolish slavery. God does not do that. God is even allow it to stay up to the day of the judgment.
One of the most progressive countries nowadays. The founders were slave owners themselves. We see American slavery showing us the one of the ugliest forms of slavery, and this was up until a few.
That's show that God is same is a human, not a God anymore.
100 years ago. Mm-hmm. Slavery was widespread in the ancient world.
And always the rubbish argument, they took a long time to explain it. It's like we don't know. I told you, God is different from human. You cannot justify doing wrong by human, by God. You know, God is different. He's supposed to know everything and understand everything.
Islamic faith could not come in and say that as of 12:01 a.m. tomorrow morning,
he is God and he have the be and to be. You know, he have a magic just say to think be and to be.
Slaves are set free because then the slaves themselves,
yeah, why
would be economically disadvantaged. They would
when God say every person, everything living in any place, he will take care of it. So you're talking always, you putting God in a small place and you compare him with humans' behavior and practice.
Be without work and without a means of sustaining themselves as a large population. You could, of course, free one person at a time, and the one person at a time would find a reasonable means of sustenance, but the whole population all at once.
It's like he dancing around the question without even getting to the question. We're talking about concubines, bro.
So you could not.
You see, when you're talking about concubines, he go into slave. When you're talking about slave, he go into other thing and those people and America and this and that.
Find jobs for all of them all at once. And so, though they were slaves and their conditions were bad, or somewhat bad, at least in comparative terms, if we think about the fact that they were enjoined to be treated well.
Always when people say something and go back and correct it, you know, is something there.
In the Muslim society, but still, at least they had a source of livelihood. But if you freed them all.
Yeah, that's the logic. If you free them all, they're going to go and they're going to die and they're not going to have food and da-da, but you have to keep them down there in the houses working. Well, the concubines, you're not just working in the house. She working in the house, she doing everything, and the night time you get up and you rape her. She accept to be raped? Any woman going to accept to be raped every night? I don't think so.
All at once, you could not, as a society, at least that nascent Islamic society, could not guarantee the welfare of all of these individuals who would suddenly be free.
Of course, God could have enjoined the changing of society to make that, you know, to make it possible that slaves would be able to thrive in its society.
Yes, and in fact, this is what was eventually done. The Quran took the gradual approach of prescribing the freeing of slaves for certain.
As until now, he's still going around the question, and he didn't give us any proper answer to any of these questions. And the main point he's trying to make true is that the Quran allowing for freeing the slave, so it's okay to own slaves.
Sins and as an act of goodwill, and of course closing off the supply of new slaves.
Jihad is the main source of the slavery in the Islam, and it's not closed up. Even you can buy slaves from the market and you can gift them to other people and can be gifted and can be inherited. And other source that people fail to mention is the newborn slaves. So when you own a slave and they have babies, their babies become slaves. So you're not closing here any sources of the slavery, you're just making them legal, and you make laws to organize this trade.
The one problem that remains to be discussed squarely is the problem of concubinage, where...
Okay, now he's going to address the main problem of the concubines. Let's see what he's going to say.
In classical Islamic law, it was recognized that if a man owned a female slave, he had the automatic right to have intimacy with her.
This rule is agreed upon by most of the scholar, and you as a scholar have nothing to say about it unless you made a book and you clarify where the mistakes is.
So this obviously is not going to be acceptable to people in modern times.
Well, yes, it is not acceptable to people to the modern time, but we here talking about Islam and his scripture.
Not even to Muslims.
Mm-hmm.
And
if you're not acceptable to you as a Muslim, it means you're not a Muslim, and I am wasting my time with someone who is not a believer of his religion.
If a Muslim says, well, I'm just going to submit to the Islamic law, that's how it is, I just accept it, still there will be an internal turmoil and discomfort with that aspect.
That's because they know this is not fair and this is an immoral behavior. But you here trying to make comfort of them and to tell them, don't worry, we have a justification of this and we can find a way around it. Why don't you just let people to face the fact that this is in the Islam and to choose either to stay in it or to leave it?
Of the classical Islamic tradition. And this calls for a certain degree of reinterpretation. And we can say...
It's called for a degree. Who called for it and who will made it? That's the main question Muslims still cannot have found an answer to.
When we look at the Quranic text itself, there's nothing in the...
So let's talk about the Quran and see in the Quran if there is the concubine or not.
Quranic text properly interpreted with Quranic text itself. There's nothing in the Quranic text properly interpreted which would necessitate that this has to be done or that.
Yes, there is, and there is plenty of it, not in one or two verses, and many of authentic ahadith. So let's see until the end what he's going to say.
Even that it was actually done.
It was actually done, or you don't know of the captive of Otas?
So we couldn't prove from the Quran itself that one would have this automatic right.
Okay, let's prove from the Quran that the one he have automatic right to sleep with his slave servant. As he says in Surah 4, verse 24, the Quran stated, وَالْمُحْصَنَاتُ مِنَ النِّسَاءِ إِلَّا مَا مَلَكَتْ أَيْمَانُكُمْ. He said, also forbidden are the married women except female captive in your possession. This is Allah command to you. So what is he talking about in Surah An-Nisa? He's talking about who not allowed to you to have sex. So when he said except, he mean except this one. This woman he say here before, your sisters and your mothers, they are forbidden for you. But those are not forbidden for you, the one your right hand possess. So you say the Quran does not say, but it is clear, plain text Arabic. Anybody can understand that Quran allowed to have sex with concubines.
The female slaves are spoken about in the Quran, for example, in Surah 4, verse number 24.
Yeah.
It is apparent that the slave women were to be married off.
Where did the hell you bring this one? They have to be married off. In the old tafsir, the act of the marriage is so different from the oath of the hand right possess. If we go to the explanation of this verse, he said, forbidden woman already married except for female slaves. They are already married, but when they get as a captive, you are allowed to have sex with them. وَالْمُحْصَنَاتُ مِنَ النِّسَاءِ إِلَّا مَلَكَتْ أَيْمَانُكُمْ. Also, women already married except those whom your right hand possess. Allah mean you are prohibited from marrying women who are already married. Except those whom your right hand possess. Except those whom you acquire through war. For you are allowed such a woman after making sure they are not pregnant. You hear you make sure they are not pregnant only by one menstruation period. In the married, you wait in 3 or 4 months. It's so different. Imam Ahmad record that Abu Sa'd al-Khudari said, we capture some women from the era of Autas who were already married. So the messenger companion captured a woman from Autas, a place called Autas is after the Battle of Hunain when they ran away to a place called Otas. The Prophet sent a military to them and they defeat them and capture a married woman. And the companion dislike having sex relation with them because they are already have husband. So because they have already have husband, the companion dislike, they don't want to have sex with them. We ask the Prophet. So what they do, they go to the Prophet and ask him about this matter. So this verse is coming after this thing happened, and the verse coming to clarify to the Prophet that they are allowed to have sex with them.
Rather than just simply taken by the owner and against her will and treated as his concubine.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, in the hadith and in...
He say this one, I think, because he read some other commentator that disagree about this thing that you're not allowed. But I think he don't understand proper the argument, because some say in the Quran, there is a verse said that you cannot marry the woman that disbeliever, not like... she is Christian or Jew. But when this happened, some commentator said it must they enter the Islam, and his companion they get married them. But Ibn al-Qayyim al-Jawziyah and other replied to this argument by a logical way, and they say it is impossible that all of these concubines, like there was about hundreds of them, they will enter the Islam all willingly, because it is impossible all of them to say, oh okay, we're going to enter Islam to allow the companion of the messenger to have sex with us. If they're not going to get to the Islam, so the companion cannot have sex with them. Concubines, there are two differences than marrying is you have an act and you marry a woman, and you're only allowed to marry Christian or Jew woman. But in the concubines of the war, you are allowed to have sex with them, because that it is not a marriage, that is an oath of hand right possess.
Classical Islamic tradition, it is widely recognized that the slave owner would have this right, but I'm saying that it's not a necessary conclusion for all Muslims.
Yes, it's a necessary conclusion, and all the scholar of the Islamic world since the Islam started until now all agree upon this one, that the slaves, you have automatic right to sleep with them.
Especially since it is not so clear in the Quran.
It is very clear in the Quran, you just don't want to see it.
Itself.
Mm-hmm. Dr. Bir, if you take this view, what implications does this have, you know, a wider implications?
So he said not clear in the Quran, and the Hadith as well here, the same thing. Because some will argue where you bring this Hadith of Otas and if he's authentic or no. Yes, the Hadith is authentic and in so many books, and here the one who narrate the Hadith, it they say. And we don't have just one or two a Hadith, we have a whole section in the Fiqh or in the classical Fiqh dealing with these laws of slaves and how you sell them, how they're going to leave, all this one. You didn't see none of this, and you just like dancing around the question without a proper answers.
Implications for Islamic law and the way we understand and interpret Islamic law.
The implication would be simply that whereas we have taken it for granted that because the companions of the Prophet, peace be upon him, did something, or it is mentioned that the Prophet, peace be upon him, did something, that that automatically becomes a precedent for us. Now we can step back and say that, okay, maybe they did certain things which were suitable to their time and place. And if they were here today, they wouldn't do the same things because it wouldn't.
That's all what we try to say to Muslim. If Islam was the religion of God, we don't have this problem. But because the Islam is the product of people who live in the 7th century, of course, if they come in this century and born here, they won't do that. Mean that this scripture is not from God and it was from them. Thank you guys for watching and see you again for another video.